With that, let's get started. So this talk is building escape rooms and arcade machines. I'm Mike Sully. And before we dive into the topic, I wanted to just give a brief background on myself. I'm a game designer by trade. I studied animation when I was at school because at the time I didn't actually know that game design was a whole field. I just thought that they were animators and they were programmers and had like a vague idea there was QA. But at the time, I thought I wanted to be an animator for games. Turns out I don't really have the patience to be an animator. It's an intense career. But I learned a lot about timing and kind of the feeling of motion and characters while I was at school. And I started out in games, making flash games on Newgrounds.com, which I don't know if that's popular in Germany, but it was really popular in the US. We would waste a lot of time in school on Newgrounds when the teachers weren't watching in computer lab playing little browser games. And so when I studied animation, I was interested in games, and my natural first step was to just start making little flash games and posting them online. And eventually I had a few that started to get a little popular, and I started making them more and more. And I got approached by an educational games group that was making flash games for classrooms that taught math. And that was my first ever time that I got paid to make a video game. That was in 2014. From there, that was around the time I moved to Los Angeles. I started working at larger studios, primarily on kids' games and mini games. I did 10 mini games for Doc McStuffins Disney Junior in 1 year, which was one of the most intense years of my life. Just like one mini game every month. And I worked for a couple mobile studios. I learned a lot about data analytics and kind of the pipeline and the process of how games are made on big teams. In 2017, I'm really into escape rooms, just like as a fan. I had played a bunch. I love puzzles. My friends and I, who are game designers, started making little escape rooms for ourselves, just kind of at like parties, amateur. And I got approached by Two Bit Circus, which is it's like a barcade immersive entertainment place in Los Angeles. And they were looking to make escape rooms that were half escape room and half video game. And I was a video game developer, really into escape rooms, and this was like a really good partnership. And so I basically, when they made that offer, I dropped everything and I was like, I'm doing this now. I'm out of mobile, I'm out of web, I'm going into this location-based route. And I'll talk about those are the escape rooms that I've developed. And then most recently, today I run a company called Coin Crew Games that builds and manufactures arcade games. And so I've kind of gone through like a big gamut from mobile and web to large scale games. I've never been in AAA, but I think there's a lot of through lines when it comes to just like bite-sized, quick to pick up games. So a few of the projects that I've been a part of and worked on. This is Space Squad. It was the first room scale game I ever made professionally with 2-Bit Circus. The premise of this one was it's for 4 to 6 players, and the idea is everyone has to work together to figure out how to turn on a spaceship and then crew it to complete a mission. The way it works is the whole room takes place in this kind of like horseshoe-shaped bridge of a spaceship. And every station is a role. So this is the gunner table. This is like the science officer, captain. This is like the engineer station. And essentially it's half puzzles because you got to figure out how to turn on the ship, and you have to kind of figure out what your mission is. And the other half of it is action because you actually have health and you can die and you can respawn. And that was the first room I did. The second room I did, also with the same client, 2-Bit Circus, was this room was called Dr. Botcher's Minute Med School. And the idea is it's kind of like a life-size game of Operation. You're doing puppet surgery. It's this really weird, silly game. The co-founder of Two Bit Circus basically was like, I want to make a surgery simulator. And my first reaction was like, ew, that sounds really disturbing. And then he was like, puppets. And I was like, okay, I'm in now. I'm very squeamish. And so at first I was a little scared of what this was going to be, but we figured it out. This is also a room for between 3 and 6 players. It's really frantic. It's very hectic. I'd say 30% puzzles, 70% dexterity games. But it does have an escape room feel. There's things you unlock as the room moves on. And so those are the two commercial escape rooms that I've been a part of producing. When it comes to arcade games, my biggest game that I've been a part of, and I think this is the only game that I have worked on that is in Germany. If anybody's seen it, call out if I'm wrong and it hasn't made it to Germany. It's at least in the EU. Hopefully it'll make it to Germany soon. This is Hot Wheels King of the Road. It's a 6-player casual racing game. It was the first release, like the first full release of Coin Crew Games, and kind of the thing that where we went from a couple guys working in a garage to a real company was when this game launched. This was the one that kind of made the company feel very official and got us the funding to actually get an office. Our second game, and this is in soft launch in maybe 5 arcades in Los Angeles, is a game called Battle Bowling. It's the weirdest game I've ever worked on because essentially everybody is a bowling ball racing through different levels. There's a farm level, there's a sci-fi level, there's like an ancient medieval level, and essentially everybody races to the pins by rolling big glowing track balls. And this game is really fun and really weird, and it's kind of our problem child game, because everybody who plays it loves it, but nobody wants to play it at first because it's too weird looking. And so this one for us has been it's been a real learning experience as far as how to build a game that is both attractive and fun, but also understandable. And our third game, which was in the prototyping phase, we were just prototyping this when COVID started, and so it's on hold right now, is a game called Pizzapocalypse. It's a post-apocalyptic pizza delivery game for 4 players, where everybody is essentially playing the different roles of like a military jeep. So one player is the driver, you have 2 players on turrets, you have 1 player riding shotgun, and essentially this is a raw wood prototype just quickly painted up that we took to 1 or 2 events and got really good feedback. Everybody was loving it. Here's some concept art of what the final cabinet factor was going to look like. We were just teeing this up to start building when the pandemic started. And so this one's on hold right now. It'll probably be one of the first projects we get back to when we come off ice. So before I get too deep into the topic of how we build these attractions, I wanted to kind of take a moment to talk about how escape rooms and arcade games, building them is similar in a lot of ways, but it's also, there's some important differences. And I think the biggest difference between an arcade game and an escape room is like the level of intensity of the experience. Because an escape room, I'm sorry, an arcade game is super casual. It's really cheap to play. It's, you put in a quarter, maybe up to $1, $2 if it's a premium game, and you play it for essentially 3 minutes. So it's a very low investment thing. Nobody really goes out of their home to play one arcade game. It's just usually something almost more like a snack. Like you see it and you go, oh yeah, I'll put a quarter in that. The fact that there's a whole game room of games might draw people in, but usually they want the bar, they want kind of the overall experience. And in some ways, an arcade game is kind of like when you're at the grocery store and you see like the Snickers bar in the checkout lane, and you go, yeah, all right, I'll put down a dollar for that. And so a lot of what you're doing with arcade games is really trying to be like casual, capture people's attention, and, you know, just give a quick fun play. And then also arcade games often give out tickets, and the tickets can be redeemed for prizes. You don't see that at barcades as much, but at the arcades aimed at a younger audience, you'll usually see there's like prize redemption rooms. And if you, you know, if you win like 10 games, you can get a little toy or a candy bar. Or if you save up your tickets and you, you know, come in every weekend, eventually you can win a big prize, like an Xbox or something. You know, it's interesting. Most arcade games support this. Some are all about it. You see like big ticket wheels and they end up like child casinos. I don't really like that kind of stuff personally, but it's an important part of the arcade ecosystem. Then when it comes to escape rooms, these are much more hardcore experiences. They're expensive. They have a long play time. These are the kind of things people will actually go to the venue to do. It's like you're willing to drive 15, 20 minutes to do an escape room. And so it's a lot more intensive. People have a higher expectation of it. And it needs an attendant to sell tickets, somebody to reset it between groups. It's a bigger investment piece. But I think they both have a lot in common. They both have a lot in common in terms of it's out of home. They're both physical. They're both like fundamentally social experiences. And somebody's going to spill beer on it. Somebody's going to kick it. Somebody's going to swing from it. Guests are amazing. You would not believe the kind of destruction that they wreak like on the equipment. And so like when it comes to building it and thinking about it and operating it, there is really a lot of similarities, even though from a game design perspective and from an economics perspective, they're their own beasts. And it's also worth noting that I think Coin Crew Games is a bit weird in that we're kind of double dipping in both worlds. Most companies either do one or the other, and we're kind of one foot in one foot in the other. That's not super usual. So the meat of this talk is just a walk through how we build our games from the first concept up to when it goes live. And so I kind of broke this up into four phases that the process goes through. We start out with ideation. Once we have an idea we like, we take it into a prototype. From there, we go to a soft launch. And fourth, it's, you know, full launch and live ops. These steps are basically identical to the steps of making a mobile game. And coming from a mobile background, I kind of think of it that way. Like, I actually think there's a lot of overlap between developing, optimizing, launching a mobile game and doing the same for a location-based game. So when we build our games, personally, when we first founded the company, we set out just kind of some general design philosophy tenets that we want to stick to. I think that's like a lot of game studios have a certain brand that you associate with their content, like what a Bethesda game is, you know, means something. There's a general Bethesda feel, there's a general Supercell feel. And when we started Coin Crew, there was a couple things that we also wanted to be the Coin Crew feel. And these things are things that we think we can really capitalize on and make sense both creatively and financially in the location-based space. And first and foremost, with everything we do and everything I do personally, it's all about social multiplayer. Because at the end of the day, with these location-based games, with these immersive games, people want a fun game, but like fundamentally what they really want is a chance to hang out with their friends in a cool way. You go to a bar to drink, but you go to a bar mostly to hang out with your friends that you came there with, and it makes the socializing more easy. You go to an escape room because you want to play a game, but also because it might be team building for your company, because it's somebody's birthday, because you want something to do. So when we're constructing these games, we always are primarily thinking about how can we make it fun for a group and, you know, lead to good group dynamics. Approachable themes is an important one, one that was really driven home for us when we developed Battle Bowling, in that when you ask people to pay to play your game, they don't get to try it out for free and then decide they want it. These things don't usually get a lot of press around them, so they haven't probably, unless it's a smash hit, read any article saying it's good, you should try it. They just usually see a thing and go, should I put a dollar in that? Or they see it and go, should I pay $20 and get all my friends in there? And so people's barrier against things that they're not sure about is really high. And when we're designing now, we try to make sure that there's like a lot of appeal just from the premise, from just looking at it, that goes, I want to try that. We try to appeal to kids and adults because the audiences that tend to go to these out-of-home venues are dates, double dates, and families are like the key drivers of who's, and birthday parties are the key drivers of who's out to play. And so if we can design content where kids are going to want to play it and adults are going to want to play it, we can, you know, hit this spectrum of players. And I always think of like Pixar being so, so good at this, where the movies, children love Pixar movies, teenagers love Pixar movies, adults love Pixar movies. They just have this really like magical sauce to these movies that just cuts across demographics. And when I am designing games, I want to approach that standard. I can't say I've ever gotten there, but you know, that's our goal. And lastly, easy to service and repair. When you build this equipment, like I was saying, people are wild. They will break things beyond your, like beyond your imagination. They'll stand on things, they'll kick things, and they're not even being malicious. They're just drunk. And so it's important to service and repair these machines easily. And so when we're designing a game, those are kind of the four key points. And if it doesn't have that, we're, you know, we're off base. And so our process starts with brainstorming. And we've, like, over the year or two of doing this, we've developed a more formal process, but essentially every Friday at our company is dedicated to brainstorming new designs. And so we're always, you know, coming up with potential ideas. These are some sketches for just different attractions. When we're brainstorming, we just like to be fast and loose and get everybody on the team just, you know, jotting down as many ideas as possible and pitching them to each other. This here is my little sketch of the game that would go on to be Pizza Apocalypse. This was the first drawing of it. This one I really like. I hope we make this someday. It's a game where the controls are beer taps and you pull the beer taps to, it's like a bartending game. And you know, there's a lot of ideas, and we just try to be really freeform with it. 90% of the ideas are either not realistic, bad ideas, questionable ideas. You know, we throw it all out there and see what sticks. From this point, once we have, you know, I'd say in our backlog, we probably have like 50 of these ideas, of which maybe we like 10 of them. From there, our next step is taking a game concept and making a quick, you know, 6 or 8 page pitch deck of it. And in this pitch deck, we try to highlight the key features, the controls, kind of what we think the economic model of this is. And essentially it's like a way to convince each other of the idea. We don't usually actually end up pitching anybody outside of the company with these pitch decks. They're totally internal. But essentially, it's a good exercise for kind of kicking the tires of our thinking and making sure we're not missing any steps. Once you have to write down the economics, it makes you acknowledge the realities of, you know, how many people can fit on this thing, how long are the games, how long is it down for between rounds. when we have to write up what the controls are going to be. If our idea is ridiculous, it kind of becomes evident here. And we also, early on, we try to think of what potential licenses this game could have. We don't always put an IP to our content, but we like to put ourselves in a position where if we wanted to pivot this idea and make it a branded game, we could do it. And it's we've learned this lesson kind of through trial and error, starting upfront with, hey, if this can't stand on its own, and we needed to approach a brand, is there somebody we can talk to? This pitch deck here is the actual pitch deck for the game that would become Pizza Apocalypse. And so this is the real thing. We presented this to each other. We all liked the idea. And so we greenlit it, which takes us to the second stage of our development, prototyping. So the first step, once we're all on board and we say this is the game we want to spend a couple months building out and developing, I always see prototyping as a way of finding out, like, does this idea have legs? Is there something strong here? Should we keep pursuing it? Hold on, I'm sorry, my cat literally just jumped up on the keyboard and pressed the button. We're back. Sorry. I warned you that would happen. That was not an exaggeration. I have a spray bottle here in case it's needed for defense. this is a framework that I actually started. I learned it when I was doing mobile game design at Age of Learning from one of my mentors there. And what she liked to do was before actually building a prototype of a game, really explicitly, like, come up with a list of the questions that you're hoping the prototype will answer. And I just, like, I love this framework. I really like playtesting and kind of like the scientific method and like gathering research. And so this always clicked with me. And when we started Coin Crew, I wanted to bring this methodology over. So usually we make a list of, you know, between 5 and 10 questions that are like the high risk assumptions about this game that could make, you know, that could be the difference between this thing is a hit and this thing is a flop. And we want to find out as soon as possible if we can alleviate those concerns. And so with Pizza Apocalypse, which is a game where there's 4 players and there's different roles and everybody's got to work together, the biggest questions that were on my mind was, like, is there enough to do with it for everyone? Is one player, you know, sitting out while everybody else is having all the fun? How does it play as a 1-player, 2-player, 3-player, 4-player? And how does it actually feel to get everybody, you know, sitting in this fake Jeep playing together? And then there were some other questions we had, but those are essentially the big burning questions. And so my goal is I want to answer those as soon as possible, because those things can really make or break the experience. And so next, whoever's the game designer on the project writes up a GDD. It's pretty standard stuff, just kind of with, like, the overall concept that we're gonna build off of. We, whenever possible, do a paper prototype, especially, like, super especially for escape room design. Paper prototyping is so amazing because, I mean, really most of the puzzles, like most of the structure, like, you don't need anything besides some paper and like a couple people to facilitate it. You can be like a human lock, you know, it's like, it's locked. Tell me the password. And if they tell you the password, you hand them the next packet of information. And I just, like, I swear by this because you can go from starting the project on Monday, having a rough puzzle design on Wednesday, to playing it on Friday, and then by the next Monday, you've kind of validated or pivoted some of your assumptions about the room. And so I don't do this very much with arcade games, but with escape rooms, I love it. And I definitely recommend, just in all game development, I've had a really good time with paper prototyping whenever it's possible. I mean, I know people, like friends of mine, who do paper prototypes for their FPSs in I don't know what to call it, like mid-core, not quite AAA development, but like not quite indie development. And they've just had a ton of, you know, success doing like board game-esque prototypes of their first person shooters. I've never done that. That seems intense to me, but I love it for escape rooms, and I'm sure someday I'll try it out for some other games too. When it comes to our software development, we build all of our arcade games in Unity. We run our games on dedicated Windows PCs, and essentially before we've built any hardware, we just test on Xbox controllers. And so every game kind of starts out as like a couch co-op game. Honestly, kind of unique in a way, is that because the escape rooms that I've worked on and that we've been brought in to help with are so video gamic, I'm not sure what the adjective is, because there is so much like video games. We've done our development for that in Unity too. And I think that's very atypical. That's a weird thing. I know like a couple immersive art installations that have done similar things. It's possible. I honestly don't know if I'd recommend it as far as approach goes, but we've had pretty good luck with it. So yeah, what's going on under the hood on these arcade games from the prototype to the real finished thing is very standard software stack. Like it's a Windows PC, it's running a Unity executable. We use a plugin called Rewired. I don't know if any of y'all have used Rewired before, but it's like one of my favorite packages on the Unity Asset Store. It gives you like a level of abstraction between the input controls and the outputs of the game. So essentially it's like a middleware that I can hook Xbox controllers into, I can hook keyboards into, and I can hook our custom controllers into. And essentially the game, you know, Rewired, then the game is talking to Rewired. And so I don't have to do any custom code, like no custom code at all. Difference between rolling a trackball and playing with an Xbox controller. It's so awesome. Of course, we have to write custom firmware to get data out of those trackballs, but essentially it's like any use controller system. Rewired, look it up. I don't get paid when people buy it. I plug it for free. It's so good. All right, prototype hardware can be super, super rough at first because it's all about getting the form factor and the controls right. This here is the prototype hardware of Battle Bowling. It was literally two trackballs glued to a picnic table, and we got two TVs on steel truss. Here was the prototype for the game that went on to become Hot Wheels. It was, you know, steering wheels and pedals, just a really rough wood box. This is the prototype of Dr. Botcher's Minute Med School. This was a fashion mannequin was our first patient. This here is Eric, who's the co-founder of 2-Bit Circus, and this room was his idea. And yeah, this thing was it was slapped together, open frame monitors, everything is just, you know, wildly, wildly rough. But that's good because you want to be able to change a lot and it doesn't need to be perfect at first. As long as it's like safe and you're not going to injure people on it and it's not going to literally collapse, like that's good enough at this stage. Also, I like to be cheap because the hardware can get expensive. And so by, you know, gradually upping the fidelity, you have more room for iteration. And the most, like the absolutely most important phase of this for me is playtesting. We run a playtest about every month on the games we're working on. Sometimes it slips, sometimes we do it more, but about every month is the frequency we aim for. And one of our goals with playtesting these experiences is not to invite repeat guests. Arcade games are kind of like things you usually play once, you might play it twice, but I would say 90% of our players at least have never played our games before. So it's important that everybody who's playing it is kind of getting like a first blush experience with it. And it's so important for escape rooms because, you know, you don't want people who already know the solution to the puzzle. So when we run our playtests, they're usually invitational type things at our studio. We have a space kind of dedicated for playtesting, and we try to cultivate like a party atmosphere because we want to try and simulate the real conditions as much as possible. So we let people bring their friends. We have music, we have food and drinks and snacks. I mean, actually, that's pretty common for most video game playtests to have like pizza or something. But we just try to make it like a hangout. And during the hangout, people are playing the games. And like all the regular playtesting protocol. Sorry, spraying the cat that's trying to step on my keyboard. All the regular playtesting protocol applies. We have somebody proctoring, somebody taking notes, try not to bias the players. We're recording video, etc. I mean, just general good playtesting practice that applies to mobile, it applies to console. And I think, like, in a cool way, playtesting arcade stuff is almost easier because with mobile games, there's always like this barrier that I've felt where you bring in the player, they come to your space, they're playing your mobile game, but that's not like the real condition they would play the game under. Like, really, they're gonna play it on the subway, they're gonna play it on the couch, play it like in the bathroom. Like, you'll never know what the real environment that they're gonna play this game is in. And so you always have like one step of disconnect, one step of like a little bit of awkwardness. It doesn't invalidate the playtesting by any means, but it's just, a little harder. But with the arcade stuff, like you can get pretty one-to-one with the real conditions, with the exception being payment. I like to say that no financial data whatsoever is valid from these playtests. Like, people will play something for free when they're invited and there's pizza and beer that they would never put a dollar into. And so, like, we more are like playtesting UX, playtesting gameplay, but we try not to extrapolate financials from these invitational free playtests. And lastly, this is where we like to look at the design questions we start with and, make sure that we're answering them. Here's a couple pictures from playtests we've done over the years. This is people playing that Battle Bowling prototype on the picnic table. Something we learned from the very first playtest that was a problem up until the production model of this game was that people put their beer on the table, then they start rolling the trackball, and they punch the beer with great force, and it goes flying into the TV and it spills everywhere. And I was like the second player to play the game had this problem. And so the final thing is cup holders. But like that was something we learned just from day one. And then here's like a slightly more advanced prototype of Battle Bowling, where it's like on a rough wood cabinet when we were trying to hone in on the form factor. Here was the first playtest of Pizzapocalypse. It originally didn't even have a pizza theme when we started it. It was just like a generic apocalypse shooter. And something we learned from this playtest was people were not into that. Who are we fighting? Why does it matter? This overwhelming feedback was like, that was cool, but like, what was the point? I want a story. And that's when the pizza story came in. And here's two other screenshot or photos of Pizzapocalypse playtesting at a later date. If you notice here, everybody's still playing on Xbox controllers because we didn't have the guns working yet. And here we never got the light gun shotgun working in time for this playtest. So this is actually a Wii Zapper. That is it's a Wii Zapper shotgun that's controlling the game. Like, the hardware doesn't have to be the real thing to find out, what works and what doesn't work. So that's essentially the play testing phase. From there, at the end of the play testing phase, oh, and of course, iteration. It goes without saying that usually we play test it, we learn something, we go back, iterate, do another play test, go back, iterate. And either we feel like we're getting somewhere with this game and it's good and it's got legs and we should take it further, or it's kind of close, but it's off And that's when we do like big pivots, big changes, going from no, you know, completely changing the theme of the game from a, you know, kind of like a more borderland serious thing to a pizza delivery comedic thing. But this playtesting process can really take anywhere from like 2 to 4 months. And sometimes we have two games being developed in parallel. So I don't mean to say it's like a straight ahead where you build the thing and then you playtest it and then you go ahead. This is kind of the prototyping phase can be a really ongoing thing. It can be a graveyard of ideas, because sometimes we just find out that it's not hitting our design goals. It doesn't really feel like it's working. And you got to be willing to let go of it when it's not working. I'd say usually from the first playtest, we can know whether or not we're on the right track. But yeah, once the game has been playtested, we all like it, we feel like it's strong, we go into the third phase of development, which is a soft launch. And that soft launch starts by building the first real cabinet. This process is intense, because we do the fabrication of the first few units in our workshop ourselves. The machines usually build them out of either wood or a combo of wood and polycarbonate. And our head of fabrication is, he's named Tim, he's awesome. This is kind of like where he shines and where I just help out where I can. I'm not a fabricator by trade, so I can swing a hammer, but I can't do it any better than the average person. So, you know, I can't really speak to the super technicals of the fabrication process. Afterwards, if you have questions about it, I can probably answer them to some degree. But it's like I said, I won't pretend to be an expert at this. I'm a novice. We do our initial CAD in Fusion 360, then we CNC the wood, assemble it. This is a shot from our workshop. These are frames for battle bowling. And the goal of this stage is essentially to create a real version of the game that can like live on site at an arcade. People can pay to play it. So it's gotta be sturdy. It's gotta be safe. It's got to be waterproof. I am not kidding. These things are like soaked in beer. When we launch a game, there are certain like fire safety protocols in Los Angeles and in the U.S. as a whole. But one of the tests is basically an inspector comes along and pours a liter of water on the machine. It's called the 1 liter pour test. And it's the scariest part of the whole thing, because it just feels bad. Cause like we do it internally. Like we do pour water on them to make sure it holds up, but we're always kind of squeamish, you know, we're like, cause we're scared. But these inspectors, I swear they enjoy it. Like you can see it on their face. They come up and they just like, it's not a drizzle. It's just like, boom, there's a liter of water on your machine. And then we look inside and make sure nothing's dripping or, you know, going to cause a fire hazard. And so the goal of this first article unit is like, it's got to be a real machine, but it doesn't have to be the final design. Like things are going to change. It's going to evolve. It has to be real, but it doesn't have to be final. And so because of that, it can be a little one of a kind. It can be a little quirky with the design. Here's some shots of us fabricating this. This is our creative director. He's painting the top of it with a hand roller. I'm feeding cables, doing a primer treatment. Here's the side of the unit. These steel bars are basically for structural support. And here's our first pass at the battle bowling cabinet. So During the fabrication process, we usually do like a vinyl wrap graphics treatment on the sides of it. And this, we work with a local LA shop. Interestingly, a friend of mine who I studied animation with back in the complete other side of the country in Massachusetts in my program, he also came out to LA. He's pretty much in charge of this vinyl shop. And so it was like a weird synergistic partnership that two people, we both knew each other, went different ways, reconvened, and now he's our vendor for this stuff. So eventually we end up with a unit like this, and this thing is ready for, it's ready for the prime time. And so the next step is to install it in an arcade. And that process usually involves renting a truck, putting it in the back of a truck. We rent the trucks because we just do such low volume that we haven't yet bought a truck, but we probably will eventually. And then taking it to an arcade, installing it there, putting in the bill collection systems, et cetera. When it comes to choosing our test partners, that's probably one of the biggest things that I've learned from doing this is having good test partners is everything. Because if we really work hard to cultivate like a good relationship with a couple local arcades that can be our test sites for everything we do. That's not bespoke for a specific client. Like if we're trying to sell something, we always take it to these test partners first. 2-Bit Circus, the company that we work with to build the escape rooms, also has an arcade room, and they're so awesome. Like we bring everything to them first, and like part of that process is like we want like a real partner who is equally invested in our success and is willing to show us data from other games and let us hang out, let us come in on odd hours to do servicing and repairs. Like we want all that to be easy, and we want like it's a back and forth because usually when these units are on test in soft launch, we're splitting the revenue with the location. So essentially, if somebody puts $1 into the machine, we keep 50 cents and the venue keeps 50 cents, and we don't charge them anything to have the machine there. We put it in for free. And so it's like, it's a synergistic relationship. And on the right here, you can see, this was the installation for Space Squad, the escape room before it opened. This is a mix of the fabrication team from 2-Bit Circus itself, and then there's me and my partners. And when it comes to installation of something like an escape room, it's a little different because like the fabrication and installation are usually going hand in hand. You're kind of building the thing into the site. So there's usually not a process of like trucking the whole, like finishing the whole thing and then trucking it over. You're probably building it with one site in mind. And so like fabrication and installation are a little bit more intertwined. But I did want to not neglect to say that, installation of an escape room can be a pain. There's a lot of parts, there's a lot of stuff, there's like set dressing that's like not functional, but that's just, to build up the immersive side of things. And there's a whole lighting design aspect to doing escape rooms too. Where you can see there's a rack of lights up here. And these are like DMX controlled lighting rig. And a big part of the installation of Space Squad for me personally, I was like game designer on that project. And I ended up being lighting designer on that project because nobody else was like, there was no professional lighting designer. And so I was like, all right, this is kind of immersive, I'll take it on. And so a big part of the installation was just like positioning the lights and trying to get the mood of that right. So at this point, you have an attraction of some sort at the location. It's ready to take money. It's ready for guests. And so this phase, like the most important part of the soft launch is gathering data. We're trying to find out like, cool, we like this game, it play tested well, does it earn well, and how do we optimize it? And this, like, I pulled most of the way I do this straight out of like the mobile gaming playbook. Like, I learned so much about about data analytics and like the like dark magic of optimizing for monetization when I was in mobile. And I wanted to, you know, just bring that attitude into the arcade stuff. And so we have our games collecting just the normal game analytics that most mobile games do, stuff like game length, you know, win, lose percent, scores, group size. And there's some metrics that like in a home game aren't as relevant in the arcade. Like I don't have 7 day, 14 day, 21 day retention. I have 3 minute retention, like nobody's coming back. And so I don't track those, and I can't actually track who people are because the games are functionally anonymous. A quarter is a quarter. I don't have any account or profile to associate with the player. So working off anonymous data, but there's still a lot to learn. Like three of the most important metrics that I've found, like whenever I'm tuning these games, is game duration. Usually you want, in an arcade game, you usually want a dollar for a minute of gameplay is like the rough napkin math you hear people say. So if it's a 3 minute game, it's a $3 game. If it's a 2 minute game, it's a $2 game. And so we really track how long the average game is and make sure that the price point is fair. And usually you actually don't want a super long arcade game because people get bored and there's like nothing worse than a player quitting. Because these are social games, and if somebody in the friend group literally walks away from the game, probably the whole friend group is going to walk away from the game. And so we really try to optimize to prevent that kind of churn, which is something else that I try to detect in the data, is like looking at what percentage of people walk away. This data, I think this was a screenshot from the first version. No, this is Battle Bowling. So we had like 3% of games walked away from. That's kind of high. So we were, you know, trying to fix that. Continue percent is another one. Essentially, when the game ends, this has been a thing since like the 80s arcade games. When you lose or when the game ends, a big pop-up comes up that says like, do you want to play again? Insert quarter or insert credit. And we track what percentage of games people actually do that on. And that's like a good kind of proxy metric for like how sticky the thing is. It's not like, you know, you can't take the absolute number of it. It's not super meaningful because you don't know whether somebody else just came up and hopped on and continued or if the same person did it. But if the numbers are high, it's good. And if the numbers are low, it's bad. And when we do a patch, we can see those numbers move up or down. It gives us a good barometer of if we've made it more or less fun. And then, so we use a mix. Those are like the gameplay metrics. There's also like a financial data side of things. And this is where the test partnerships so important because I can only gather data like from my own games because we built the software, we have, you know, access. But the venue has payment data on every game in their game room. And so with the arcade games, if you have a good partner, they will share it with us. They'll tell us what the highest earner is and how much that earned and where we rank in the list. Because with arcade games, the way people tend to like financially evaluate arcade games is their rank in the game room. Like a big arcade will have like 100 games in it. A smaller arcade might have like 25. And then sometimes you'll see like little teeny arcades in like a pizza parlor or something where they'll have like 5 or 6 machines. But it's all about how they stack up. Because as you can imagine, in like a little mom and pop arcade where it's like pretty low traffic, a high earning game might be doing $100 a week. In a booming arcade like 2-Bit Circus, a high earning game might be doing $2,000 a week. You can't really look at the absolute value, but you can say, oh, my game is ahead of Jurassic Park arcade shooter, but it's behind Big Bass Wheel. And like that relative positioning is what we use in the arcade industry to judge the quality. I'm kind of rambling about this. I'm like a really big data nerd. And so if you have more questions about this, we can come back to it, but I realize don't get me started. It's dangerous. And the third part of this is on-site observation. Like we go to the venues And we just watch people play. We like sit back with a beer, pretend to be a regular guest, kind of like sit, like, you know, try not to creep too much, and like side eye watch the thing and take notes in a notebook about what we see. Because there's a lot of stuff that like empirical numerical data can tell you, but it doesn't ever give you the full picture. You won't know how many people look at the thing and come up to it and kind of like put their face up to it and then walk away. You never know that from the numbers. And you can't know people's body language from the numbers. And so a big part during the soft launch is we try to get out at least once a week to spend a couple hours observing. And so this is an iterative process. We're doing this like with most games that are soft launched, we release version one, watch it for a while, get the numbers in, come up with some hypotheses of like what's bad and what's good, do a patch, push it to the location, and then just kind of do this again and again and see if we can get the numbers trending in the right direction. This is a real report from a arcade in Arcadia, which is a city in Los Angeles County. And you can see here is the Hot Wheels. It was in 30th place out of 130 games. And here's the Battle Bowling. It was in 39th place. When we first put the Battle Bowling there, it debuted at like 55th place. That was our first version of it. And then we did a patch and we updated it and we got down to 40th. And then we did a patch and we updated it. And we got down to like 35th. And then we did a patch and updated it. And we fell to like 70th. And we were like, oh, we broke something. Like, people don't like this anymore. And then we reverted. And so it's an iterative thing. But like, one nice thing about arcade games is that these metrics, like, they're so financially, they're so like financially analyzed that you kind of do have some good like objective yardsticks to measure how it's doing, and that's nice. Another important part of these arcade games and escape rooms is what's called the attract mode, which is essentially what your game is doing when nobody's playing it. And this is such a key driver of revenue, because your game is essentially an advertisement for itself when nobody's playing it. You want to, like, when other people are playing it, it looks fun because other people are playing it. And so you get this nice virtuous loop where the more crowded it is, the better it does, the more crowded it is, et cetera. But when nobody's playing it, you got to kind of convince people that this is going to be a fun game. And so we use like videos, kind of like a trailer playing on the cabinet when no one's there. We use LED lights. We use a little bit of audio. I find audio really annoying in attract modes, because if nobody's playing it and the game's always going, hey, 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 you know, it's like Navi in Legend of Zelda. People are like, I don't want to touch this. This thing is poison. And then the operator is going to mute it, and then your whole game's muted. And so I'm very delicate with audio, because I think you can annoy people really easily with that. But here's a unit of Battle Bowling. This is in a barcade that has like, there's like 10 other games here. And so this is just like a Instagram boomerang, so you're not getting the whole video, but you can see we're lighting these up. The trackballs themselves light up. We got the screens, even the payment acceptors are pretty bright. And so optimizing a track mode is also really important. Like, we A/B test different modes here, try to see how we can get people's attention. And I think this is also a really useful thing for any escape room that is part of a larger ecosystem. You know, if you're a lot of the escape room venues in the US have like 5 rooms in the place, or they have other stuff. They might have like some VR games in the lobby, et cetera. And so, you're gonna do most of your sales through like traditional advertising, but when people are there, you might be able to sell them on coming back another time to try one of the other games. And so what the attract mode of an escape room often looks like is like video monitors in the lobby playing a trailer of the other rooms that you have. We tried something super weird in Dr. Botcher's that I might have some pictures. It's not in the deck, but I might be able to find them afterwards. Because Dr. Botcher's is like a dexterity game and like a talking game, there's not it's not a spoiler to see the room. And so Two-Bit Circus actually has an open window and people can watch other groups play this game. And like, honestly, I was skeptical of that. I was like, that's really weird. Like, is it gonna like let the magic leak out? And it has been like for them, like just a killer driver of revenue because people are at the bar. This escape room, like the structure of Two-Bit Circus, if you're ever in LA post-pandemic, you gotta check this place out. I love it. Is like, they have like four escape rooms and an arcade and a VR like arena. And the escape rooms are pretty close to the bar. And so what happens is people like, I think there's two bars. It's close to a bar. And what happens is people are sitting at the bar and they're drinking and they're talking. And then like crazy flashing lights are going on kind of in the periphery of their vision. And they get up and they look and they see these people like running around a room doing surgery on a puppet. And it sells tickets. Like it sells so many tickets. And Dr. Botcher's now is the most popular and highest earning of the rooms that they have. It womps Space Squad, which, you know, it's weird when you got your two games competing with each other. And it's like, I feel like I'm voting for my favorite kid or something. But this was just, you know, it was just a huge driver of revenue. And I'm not saying like escape rooms should have clear windows into them or, you know, like as a general rule, I just think that being clever with the attract mode, like, is a great way to drive revenue. It does so much. And if I can get a bit mathematical for a minute, this is the cash flow formula that we use, that pretty much everyone would use when evaluating the financial performance of any of these attractions. And when I showed the pitch decks on slide, you know, slide five, and I say we brainstorm what the economics are of this, is essentially our first guess through this formula. And basically what it says is that the maximum hourly earnings of your game, of your attraction, the maximum is equal to the price that it costs per player times this thing in the bracket is called the throughput. And basically, so the price times the throughput minus any attendant wages that you're paying hourly for somebody to, you know, man the desk, give out tickets, check tickets. And throughput is calculated as like the maximum players times essentially like how long the game is. So like 60 minutes over the game length plus the reset time. And we use this, so like for example, if an escape room is $20 a person, it can support up to six people. It's an hour long with a 30-minute reset. And we're paying an attendant, let's say we're paying two people to run this thing. It's like $25 an hour. So, you know, you run that through the formula. My mental math is pretty bad. I was hoping I'd be able to do it while I was talking to you. But basically, you're gonna get some number. I think it's probably gonna be like 240 or something. You're gonna get some number. And that's the most money your attraction can possibly earn per hour. It's not going to do that like IRL. It's not going to, you know, I don't know how many maximum hours you're going to have, but it is important to realize that the earnings are capped because unlike a digital game that technically, if I release a game on Steam, it's probably not going to make me $100 million, but there's nothing fundamentally limiting the fact, like if 100 million people bought it for a dollar, I would make $100 million. It's never going to happen, but it could happen. With these escape rooms, there is like, if I had a line out the door miles long, I'm still, you know, my maximum hourly is still capped at that. And so we use this formula to kind of just like make sure that there's like a fundamentally what we're doing is sensible. Also, I think when I'm looking at this, throughput tends to be the first way that like an attraction caps out on its earnings. If it's not popular, if people like aren't really super into it, this term won't matter very much because like this is the most people you can put through the thing per hour. And if not that many people are coming, it doesn't matter. But once you're popular, this is usually what you cap out on first. And it's hard to change because adding another player, like to an arcade game, that's like almost undoable. You can't just pop on an extra controller. And if you start selling more heads, more people into your escape room, sometimes the puzzles will start to get worse. You know, it's usually this ends up pretty baked into the fundamental design. So we think about the throughput a lot when we're doing the initial design. Like I said, you got some wiggle room. Sometimes in an escape room, you think it's for six people. You can run eight people, but and this especially reset time with escape rooms is a big one, because the more stuff you got to reset, the less frequently you can run it, and the less frequently you can run it, the less money you can make. And so when we're designing escape rooms, we really take this into account, like a lot, that we want it to be really easy to reset. You know, optimally there would be no reset. If it was just like a video game, maybe there's a couple padlocks to put back on and spin. Maybe there's a couple props to put away. But whenever I'm like working on a room, I've always got the direction from whoever's in charge is like, keep the reset time down as much as possible. And, you know, like you can make a little bit more money by paying your attendants less, but that's mean. So generally, you know, that's not where I try to optimize. But optimizing for fewer attendants is a real thing. You know, if you can have one game master that runs two rooms because it's so easy to run, like, that's awesome. If you need two game masters to run one room, well, that's tough. And so basically, all that to say, we use this formula as a way to like spot check our economics. And usually when you won't need more money, you raise the price. And then people complain that it's too expensive. And that brings me to the last phase of this, which is the launch and the live ops phase. And this looks really different for every project. So this is just a couple of general things. How do we make money on these attractions? How we make money on these attractions really depends. There's three like fundamental ways that these attractions earn. One is the unit sales approach, which is like good for arcade games. And essentially what we do here is we partner with a factory, manufacture a large quantity of the game, and sell them to arcades and distributors who will wholesale them, et cetera. This is what we did with the Hot Wheels game. We partnered with a Canadian company called Adrenaline Amusements. They're a big arcade manufacturer. They also design and release their own games. And basically they are in charge of building and selling a lot of them. And we get a cut of every unit sold. That doesn't really make too much sense for an escape room because you probably only have one of it. And so what you built is the real thing. A second way we make money is through contract attraction development, which basically is when another company, like 2-Bit Circus, for example, hires us to design and build a one-of-a-kind game for them. And we get, it's usually like a flat rate, you know, it's the development budget. Sometimes there's a little percentage of sales on top of that. And that's been good for escape rooms. That's what most of the client work that we take on is like. It's like somebody wants something weird for just their brand. It's their IP. They have, you know, creative control in the process. They might even have their own team of artists or fabricators or what have you. And we'll work with them to develop this attraction for them. And then the third way to make money on this stuff is to operate it yourself. Essentially, you make money directly from the guests. Most escape rooms in the world use this model where they build the game, they run the game, they hire the attendants, they make the money. Occasionally, like I said, a company will contract out the development, but most in America are operating their own games. You can also do that with arcade equipment. You see all three business models out in the wild. We use a hybrid, some people do. I'd say most arcade game studios are in category A. Category B is kind of like you're almost like an agency if you're like primarily category B. A lot of immersive location-based stuff is that. And category C is an operator. I would say we make 70% of our revenue off unit sales, 20% of it off contracting, and like 10% of it off route operation. our route operation is pretty small. Sometimes we have games and we put them in bars with bill acceptors and we give the bar half the cut and we take half the cut. It's not, every company is a little different with this, but it is important to take the economics into account. And one of the last steps, kind of, I touched on this at the start of the talk, was IPs on, having an IP on the game. We try to design our games so that they could be rebranded if necessary, because branding is like the greatest advertising money can buy. In the arcade, in the out-of-home space, people like want comfort. They're like, should I put a dollar in this? And if it's a brand or a game that they know, they are so much more likely to put a dollar in. That being said, it's really expensive to license an IP. And then you got more red tape, you got more stakeholders on the project. So we try to develop our own IP whenever possible, but with the ability to pivot and put an external IP on it. So this game, Hot Wheels, it originally launched as just a generic kind of small car racing game. It was called King of the Road. And we tried that out in soft launch. We took it to like three locations. We even lined up the manufacturing partner at this point. And what we found was that at like places that were more experimental and hip, it was a bill printer. It was doing so, so well. Like it crushed it. And that's the sign of a fun game. But at more like conservative locations that are mostly little kids, mostly families, it was doing pretty poorly. And I just think that that generally speaks to like an attract problem, like a sense that it can be fun, but if nobody plays it, they won't know it's fun. And that is like that's the space that generally an IP can help a lot with, because the IP gets people in the door, the game has to be fun, the game keeps them playing. And so we launched with just generic, we had partnered with Adrenaline Amusements. They have a super tight knit relationship with Mattel, who's the IP holder of Hot Wheels. Kind of got a three-party deal going where Mattel came in on this. They get a cut, we get a cut, Adrenaline gets a cut. And that's how Hot Wheels King of the Road came to be. We worked with a contract, what's the word for it? Like a contract game dev studio. Like we brought on a third game dev studio to Hot Wheelsify this game, just because we were really busy. We're a small team. We had to keep developing other products. So we gave them our code base. They had sweet artists, kind of worked with them to Hot Wheelsify it. And so there's a team of like 20 Canadian game developers that we worked with to Hot Wheelsify this thing. And it came out so good. And I love their artists and kind of their like, they made it way better. So I'm really proud of the way this thing came out, but I can't pretend to be the artist or anything on it. And so that's kind of like the journey from no IP to IP. And so like on the original pitch decks, now we list at least, we try to come up with at least four different IPs that we could potentially approach. We learned that lesson the hard way with Battle Bowling. It's a fun game. It's so weird. It's such a weird game. There's no really natural license for it. And so when we hit this problem in soft launch, similar problem where at experimental venues, it just does so well. At conservative venues, it gets like no money. We're all sitting around a table going, what do we do? What license could we put on this? What's like, you know, and we were in some talks with some brands before the pandemic hit. So it's not impossible, but it's just not easy. Versus King of the Road, you know, Hot Wheels was just a great natural fit for it. And it was very easy to make the sell and make the pivot. So now with all of our products, we take into account what could this be, even if it hopefully won't be. I'm sure you can imagine a couple things that Space Squad could have been, or Dr. Botcher's could have been, potentially a Mattel board game, but I'm not saying that legally. So Pizza Apocalypse, if we needed to rebrand it, we would probably drop the pizza, make it into some other post-apocalyptic setting. You're just some sort of post-apocalyptic delivery crew. But hopefully we won't have to. And kind of the last step of the live ops process is maintenance, because for the first few months, this thing is, it's your baby. It's going to break. You're going to repair it. You're going to live at the arcade. They're going to call you up at all weird hours of the day, and they're going to tell you that something's wrong, and you're going to go in and you're going to find a pin is disconnected on the board or something, and you'll discover what the problems are and patch them and fix them. And so, like, during the live ops process, what I've found is, like, really prioritizing, like, stability and robustness of the tech and talking to the venue constantly, because they might not realize something's broken, or they're really busy. They're always really busy, and so they might not have time to call you up. They might just turn it off if it breaks. I try to write a manual that's as detailed as possible and try to get whoever else is working on it to, you know, document their stuff. Because a lot of these venues actually do have technicians, and if the manual is good enough, they can sometimes fix it themselves. And just knowing that nothing is unbreakable, like nothing is unbreakable. I worked with one industrial designer who said those like cursed Titanic words. He said, "This is unbreakable." He welded some steel. It was in Space Squad, there's one controller that's like a hand flywheel, and you turn a crank to power up the generator. And he said, "This is unbreakable." And on the first night, the very first night of this attraction being open, a guy who looked like, he looked like the Mountain from Game of Thrones, like half Thor. This guy was huge, and he was really drunk, and he was really into the game, and he just grabs it, and he turns to his friend, and it just cracks. And it got re-industrial engineered, but like nothing is unbreakable. And so what you want to do is make it like defensible. You want to make it hard to break and easy to repair. And that's kind of the maintenance process. Over time, the things just get more stable as you learn more about it and patch the bugs. With the first King of the Road unit, like this, there was an even earlier one. This was the first King of the Road unit. It was just like, it wasn't even trade dressed yet. During the first like 2 months, we were there 3 times a week fixing stuff. The pedals fell off, the wheels got loose, like the speakers failed. That was our first on-site game. We were newbies. But that's fine. Like, as long as you're there to fix it, it's no big deal, as long as it's not dangerous. But yeah, we were there like all the time. And then over the next like 2 months, we were there maybe once or twice a month. And by the end, we maybe twice a year, we would have something to change. So it does get better, you get better. But early on, just like be ready for the storm of problems. And last but not least, like, you got to remember to celebrate when you launch the stuff. This is just photos of me being happy to prove that I'm sometimes happy and the things aren't breaking all the time. These are two of my partners here. This is my co-founder, Wyatt. This is Max, our software engineer. And here's kind of some of our team and kind of key playtesters. We do have an early playtesting group that, I know I said never playtest with the same team. I almost don't count these as real playtesters. They're like the people who like come in and like help us QA and like get the early, you know, get the wheels kicked before even anybody else sees it. And so these are just a couple of our real good friends and people who advise us. And so yeah, it feels great to launch a game. Like, it's a lot of work. It's a lot of work, but there is almost nothing better than sitting at the bar, at the counter, and you're observing people play the game, and you know that if you buy fries, those fries are paid for by the people that you just saw put quarters into your game. Like, that is a great feeling. And so it's a really satisfying and gratifying thing to work on, although it will give you gray hairs because it's a lot. And I just wanted to give a couple shout outs. We're not the only indies in the arcade. Here's three of my favorites. This is Killer Queen, probably the most famous indie arcade game. It's like a 10-player game. It's kind of the only arcade esport. It's like a team versus team. It's a really intense game, but it's so fun. super fun. I think there's a version of it out on Nintendo Switch now. So check out Killer Queen. I recommend it if you like kind of competitive team-based like fast-paced games. This is Tipsy Raccoons. I think it was actually rebranded recently as Retro Raccoons. It's I love this cabinet. Like that treatment is so cool. And the cool thing about this game, as far as I know, is that to activate it, you need to have a drink in the cup holder. And so it's the only beer-powered arcade game. This thing is fun. And then lastly is Cosmatrons. This game, I met the developer of this game, if you can forgive me one little tangent. Such a cool story. I know this is recorded, so I don't know if it'll, be contested, but I he sees this. But he told me that the development story of this is just super cool. He started the game as he and his core group of friends wanted to play this game. Like they had an idea for a game that they just wanted to play themselves. And so they built it, and he built it for himself. And then more and more people wanted to buy it because it was fun. And so he's, all right, I'll make you one. And he made them one. And then more people wanted it. And it just is kind of like a really organic, cool thing. And I just love the idea of a game that's built for you and your friends, and it's like it's a really personal thing, and you can feel the personal touch in this thing. I don't know if it exists in Germany, but if you ever see it, try it out. It's fun. And kind of lastly, which is probably the elephant in the room of the whole thing, the reason that I'm able to talk to you in Germany from the US is COVID has been crazy in the arcade out of home world, because everything's closed right now. And it's not apocalyptic to our industry, because we have confidence that it's gonna rebuild over time, but it has really made us rethink the way a lot is done. Because the fundamental fact of it is that everyone's closed right now and nobody's looking to buy new stuff. So essentially all the revenue streams are temporarily at least frozen. We have a lot of faith that the underlying drive is going to return once people feel safe, and once it's safe out there again, because people want to hang out with their friends. They want to spend money. They want to drink beer. But for a while, they're not going to want to touch communal controllers. And so, the things are, they're on pause. At Coin Crew, we expect escape rooms to recover before proper arcades do. And our thinking around that is because escape rooms are you play them with an intimate group of friends. You're not going into a tight room with strangers. You're going in with your friends. And, there's this level of comfort to that. And you can really sanitize between groups. You can wipe everything down. There's a group, and then there's nobody. And then there's a group, and there's nobody. And so, I don't at all advocate for things opening too soon. But when things are safe, I think the psychological safety will cause escape rooms to return before the public arcades are popular again. Also, I think with the world going to a lot of remote work, team bonding in person, when it does occasionally happen, is going to be more so than ever. And escape rooms already make a huge percentage of their money off team bonding activities. So I think escape rooms are going to recover financially before the traditional arcades do. And it's times like that where we're thankful that we're kind of double dipping in both. And our sense is that this is just going to be a slow, gradual process that we're all monitoring. I don't think the arcade as an industry is dead by any standard, but I do think that I don't expect to get many quarters in 2020. 2021, I'll start expecting quarters again. So I don't have any super shocking insights on this specific topic, but I do know that a lot of arcade operators and manufacturers, we're all talking to each other. We got email chains, we got meetups digitally. And everybody's, everybody's riding this storm out. Some industries are not so hit. Some industries are super hit. Ours is one of the ones that's super hit, but mobile console, PC are in a great spot. I have friends at mobile companies that are doing 3x revenue. There's video games as a skill set are definitely a good one to have during this. I mean, honestly, depending on how things go, even we've considered, we haven't committed to it, but we've considered doing some digital ports of some of our games. If things go long enough, you know, we want to stay busy. And so we might try to get a home release on some of our stuff. But that sounds like a lot of work, so I haven't started it yet. And that's kind of where the COVID world is at. And that brings us to the end of my long journey of making arcade games. I want to call it rambling, but I hope it's interesting. If you want to know more, you can check out our website, coincrew.games, or my personal portfolio is at solly.com/talks. You can get these slides. And like Linus said, I think this is going to be posted on YouTube later if you want to see me use a spray bottle on a cat that's trying to step on my computer throughout the talk again. So thanks for viewing these slides with me. I think we got like 30 minutes left, so we can turn it over to Q&A.
Yeah, let's do it. Thank you so much, Mike. It was really a pleasure, this talk. Like, this is a topic we do not often talk about, and it's like a pleasure to have you. And I'm really looking forward that you're making some more money in 2021. I think this will be great. We got a whole lot of questions in the chat. So if anybody who posted a question or has a question wants to talk for themselves, feel free to do so or interrupt me. Otherwise, I will just read those questions out loud to everybody. So the first one is, how much do such machines cost?
So for the arcade machines, I would say that there's a range, but on the cheaper end, a machine might be like $6,000, and on the higher end, up to about $20,000 MSRP, like market price. Usually, these machines are built on about like a 60% margin. So, a machine that sells for like $6,000 is probably built for like $2,500. And a machine that sells for like $20,000 is probably built for like $9,000. The Hot Wheels King of the Road is, I'm not even sure what the exact number is. I'll talk about Battle Bowling because with Battle Bowling right now, we have like a sale price of that at like $8,000, and we build it. It's a little bit more expensive because we're not in mass manufacturing, so we're building those things for about $5,000. And so we're not making a lot of money on those yet, but that's okay in like this earlier soft launch phase. When we go into full production on that thing, if we want to keep selling it for $8,000, we got to get the build cost down to like 3,500. And that kind of stuff just comes with scale. If we're working with a big factory, they can source parts in bulk. They're much more efficient than we are, and so the price will just come right down. Also interesting, operating a machine, like these machines can gross and probably will gross like 5 to 8 times their MSRP over their lifetime. They usually last about 3 years before they are like not popular anymore. So if Arcade buys a game for $10,000, over the course of 3 years, they're probably going to make 30, 50, maybe even $80,000 on that machine. Of course, they're going to be servicing it. They're going to be paying the credit card processing fees. They're going to, you know, there's a lot of labor involved in that. But essentially, that's why operating machines is attractive. Selling machines is good, but if you're operating them and splitting the revenue, you can hypothetically make more money, but then you're the one maintaining it. So I hope that answers the question. It's tricky to say how much it exactly costs because also like distributors will buy wholesale. Like with the Hot Wheels deal, there's a distributor that's buying them by the like 100 from Adrenaline Amusements at a discounted rate, and then they sell to the arcade at the full price. And so like there's a, you know, you get sweetheart deals, you get bulk deals, but I want to say if you see like a like an arcade cabinet that looks like a Street Fighter cab, you know, it's like a traditional, there's a stick, there's a button, there's like a sandwich board design, that probably costs like $3,000 to make. If it's like a fancy, quirky thing, upwards of 20.
Awesome. Dealing with the very creative task of coming up with your ideas, how do you deal with creative blocks or maybe burnouts?
That's a really good question. I would say when it comes to creative block, having a, like, at least in our studio, when we were at Indie, we're a small studio, having everybody being a part of the creative design process has helped us a lot, because when I'm out of ideas, usually somebody has an idea that they're pretty passionate about is going to be like the next thing. And so usually, like, even if I'm kind of skeptical of an idea, I always try to be like open-minded and experimental and be like, okay, let's test that. Like, if I don't have any ideas and somebody else has an idea that seems weird or like out of the box, and it's like, can we test this in a month? Mm-hmm. Can we find something out? So in general, I just think being open, like not being top down with the ideas, but being just very communal has helped us. In terms of burnout, actually we're working on processes. We're not really sure what the best way like is, because I mean, crunch in video games is just such a common industry-wide problem. And so we try to avoid crunch as much as possible, but like we've messed with idea, like sometimes after a crunch, like when we know a crunch is coming up, we do a thing where it's like, in advance, this crunch is coming up, talk about it with the team, are we cool with this? And then there's like a week off afterwards, and like a paid week off. And so it's like, it's a balance of stuff. I still don't even know if that's the best way, but we're experimenting. I think the burnout would be like, I don't think there's anything specific arcade wise, escape room wise, that would make the burnout any different. I just think that's kind of the industry wide question. So I'm open to all suggestions. I think this is probably the big question of video games in the early 2020s that hopefully our industry will, get some better clarity on.
Yeah, hopefully. I think many people are struggling because of working from home and not like used to managing the day by their own. But I guess that's also another topic. So the next question is by Joseph. So the first was by Michael, the second by Markus, and the third is now by Joseph, which is, so it's a relay question from the Regional Association of Escape Rooms and Education. How would you define escape room? Like, do you draw the line, since you're talking about arcades are similar? Does it need to be multiplayer? Does it need to be a room and have a fixed countdown or so on?
That's such a good question, Joseph. It reminds me of when I was in art school and I used to get into these really long-winded fights about what is art with my fellow students. And like, we would always end like throwing up our hands and like walking out of the room. And so the definition I use right now, because honestly, a lot of like my escape rooms, to some people, like they might not really be escape rooms. You're not trying to escape the room. You're trying to do surgery or you're trying to fly a spaceship, but I call them escape rooms because that's what customers call them. Like, people say, I played this escape room because they were in a room. And so personally, I use the definition to be, I say it's an escape room if it takes place in like a isolated or encapsulated environment. Is I think important, because you're kind of setting up like an immersive space, like it's got an immersive component to it. And I think like puzzles, like having some sort of puzzle collaborative element seems important. I've played like escape rooms in a box, escape rooms. And I still think that those are like escape games. I'm not sure if they're escape rooms. So it's a fuzzy answer. I would say I call it an escape room if I think I can market it better as an escape room. Like if people's if calling it an escape room is going to align people's expectations so they have more fun and show up, then I'll call it an escape room. 2-Bit Circus actually calls their rooms they officially call them story rooms because they, you know, aren't about escape, but customers call them escape rooms. And so they've kind of accepted it. And that's when I call it an escape room. So I think the things people expect with the term escape room is they expect to be in an enclosed room. They expect there to be a time associated with it, like a time boxed limit. And I think they expect puzzles or challenges like that are going to get their mind working. I don't think it has to be multiplayer, but I've never seen a single player physical escape room. I don't think that it would still be an escape room. I just never seen one.
Yeah. Do you have, so next question is by Marcus. Marcus, do you have any data on how arcade games are received inside versus outside the US?
Yes, I do, but I'm not an expert at it. Our company primarily operates in North America, and my partner has like a pretty big background in doing amusements for the Middle East and North Africa. And so our knowledge is like North America, Middle East region, and then everything else is kind of what I've heard talking to other developers and distributors. So take with a grain of salt, because I'm very America-centric on this one. But my understanding is like North America has a big market for this. China has a big market for this, but a lot of their games are domestic to China. They will import stuff, but just a lot of the US European games are significantly more expensive when you take into account what it would mean to import them and the currency stuff. And so I just think it's really expensive to have, like I said, I'm not an expert in this though, but I think it's like cost prohibitive for a lot of US games to enter that region unless they have a really strong IP or earnings or something that makes them special. In the Middle East, there's a huge, huge growing demand for these kind of family entertainment centers. And so this has been a big area of expansion. Theme parks too are in recent history been doing really well in Saudi and in the Emirates. And so there's a demand there. In Europe, from my understanding, y'all would know more than I do. It seems like there's by looking at sales figure, there's fewer of the kind of arcades that we have in America. And so games sell there and they earn there, but we don't usually do a large quantity like of sales to that region. We with Hot Wheels, we're using a third-party distributor. We're distributing it through Bandai Namco in Europe, and I don't actually have the sales figure. I think that agreement just started in like early 2020, and as you can imagine, it's kind of all on pause now. So my data is very, very US centric. I think as the company grows, you know, we're still a startup and we're still our shoes are big and we're still trying to fill them. I think hopefully in like a year or two, we'll have a lot better picture on what the international market is really like. But for right now, I'm just really relying on a lot of like peers and mentors and just asking them questions. The Japanese games market is unique because a lot of the games that are popular in Japanese arcades are Japanese developed. And so like, while a lot of the rest of the world has similar games, the Japanese market is you see a lot of unique games there. And more recently, they've been coming to America and you'll see these like arcades like Round One Arcade that has primarily Japanese games, and they're super fun and you can't play them anywhere else. But US games going to Japan seems rarer. Japanese games coming to America seems more common because they make really good stuff.
Okay, when it comes to observing your players while they are testing, but they don't know that you're serving, Joseph asked, are you observing or do you also use like surveys to ask people about their experience and issues?
We use limited surveys. I've personally developed like a little bit of a distrust around surveys unless they're very focused on specific things. In general, I'd say we're more just observing, but after playtests, we definitely do surveys. We do exit surveys, and sometimes in the first couple weeks, we'll do some surveys, usually around like more marketing-y things, like what drew you to play this game? Was it what you expected? We've done it a little bit. I've worked with one consultant who's a marketing consultant, and he helped us do some of that. And it was good. He also helped us actually edit our our track mode videos together. And we kind of worked with him, like we made a, it was kind of cool actually. We made a camera, like a virtual camera rig in the game, and then like used OBS to record footage and like fly around and stuff. And so we gave him those tools, and he was able to like play the game and like cut together a reel. And then, you know, interview players and like we'd A/B test it. And so that was like a cool process. And so we've done it. It's not like a fundamental part of our development process, but we've done it.
Also by Joseph, I've seen people get annoyed by a bad puzzle early on, which caused them to fairly criticize puzzles later on out of frustration. So how are you dealing with this issue?
Good puzzle design question. Joseph with hard-hitting questions. let's see, like puzzle design in general. One of my favorite like authors on puzzle design is, his name is Scott Kim, and he's like the puzzle guy. And I had it was such an honor. I got to work with him directly when I was at Age of Learning, because we were making puzzles for like kindergarten age children, small children. And during that time, I would just like annoy him constantly about like puzzle design, because I was really into escape rooms at the time. And so if you want like a good authority to read about like just good puzzle design, I really recommend the stuff he's written. But in general, I think like puzzle design, like any other type of game design, like playtest, and try and resolve the frustrations through iteration. I think like strategic hint giving is important. Because when people are getting frustrated, like a well-timed hint can be helpful. Parallelism of puzzles, so that there's, you know, not just one puzzle blocking all progress and everything's like, this sucks. I've seen this a lot, where one puzzle is gating everything else and nothing advances till one puzzle is solved, and this puzzle is done by one person. Ooh, that's bad. Because when you hit that scenario, five people are standing around over the shoulder of one person who's like, let me work, and everybody's waiting. And so that stands out to me as like a questionable puzzle design moment, and that can be alleviated through parallelism, having multiple puzzles that can be solved independent of each other, and the solution to each one gives hints or help to the other puzzles, gives you a way to kind of like more organically like flow the puzzles together. Also, like puzzles that multiple people can work on and help each other with are good. Like you get some puzzles, like a logic puzzle, like for example, a logic puzzle like we sold three apples, Bill didn't buy the red apple, you know, like Sarah bought more apples than Bill, you know, like those kind of puzzles tend to be very solo. Like it's not generally helpful to collaborate on those. Usually when you have a puzzle like that, somebody gets the paper and is like, let me think, leave me alone. That kind of puzzle shouldn't be like a hard gate where the whole room is waiting on it. It's like that kind of general puzzle design stuff. I wish I had a more prepared answer on this. I feel like a bit of an imposter puzzle designer right now that I'm choking on this one, but I would just say parallelism is really important. People being able to give hints when they reach their frustration point, people being able to get hints when they reach their frustration point in a way that is not super painful. And then just like no red herrings ever. People will make up their own red herrings, a red herring being like a false lead, like a trick clue, because people will make up their own false assumptions, and you don't need to extra trick them. And so rather than having any elements that are intentionally designed to be like a dead end, those just don't tend to lead to fun gameplay.
So Joseph said, thanks. Very good answer. Okay, I got a question, which is, earlier on you said that depending on the machine, the game designer may change, or like, how do you look for who is game designer on which project, and why do you even change that?
So it's usually like practical. There's two main reasons. One is just like production wise. I'm a game designer by trade, but we're a really small team, so I'm also the producer, and the producer role just kind of comes first, because if nobody's producing, everything's going to go to chaos. And so if my load is light, I'll be the game designer on the project. And if there's a lot going on, we want to use somebody else to be the dedicated game designer, because game design is a whole discipline and it's hard and it really deserves attention. So one reason is just like production wise, if we're doing two games in parallel, each game needs a dedicated game designer and I can't be both. Another reason is like domain specialty. We did a prototype, it didn't launch. We might come back to it, which was like, it was a football game, American football game. And I like American football a lot, but I'm not really an expert of it. And so I wanted the game designer on that project to like be somebody who is really into football games, played a lot of Madden, played a lot of other sports games, just kind of like played more esportsy games, kind of like living in that world, because I think their design like is just going to be more informed than mine. So the two main reasons will change out who's the game designer on a project is production wise and is like domain expertise. If I can call him out, this is Tony Jackson, and he is a game designer I work with, and I try to work with him more. We mostly work with him on a contract basis because he's so busy, but he is an awesome game designer. He did all of our levels for Hot Wheels King of the Road. He was the one who did the football game design. Super good designer. If he ever sees this, work for us more, Tony.
Awesome. So you already gave a glimpse on the next question, but Joseph asked, with COVID probably blocking most of your business right now, since people need to attend your building in groups, have you thought about different possibilities of making money, like creating small paper-based escape games or digital versions of games?
Yes, we have thought about it. We haven't done anything we're serious yet. Like, we're kind of in monitoring mode for the next probably month to see which like, I don't know what, like how much US news anybody here follows, but a couple of states have been opening up, and we're like kind of watching to see how things go really nervously. Personally, it seems really risky that's happening, but you know, the whole US is watching itself to see, you know, what's happening where. And so depending on, I mean, I imagine it would probably be like a 3 to 4 month, 5 month process to make a digital game and ship it and release it. Maybe we could do it faster and, you know, do like early access. But if the situation looks like it's going to be going really long, we'll probably do that. If it looks like it might resume sooner than later, we might go, you know, stay the course of our current model. But we're open to pretty much all things. And like this time, there's been less work to do on this, you know, just by the nature of it. So I think a lot of us have just been also working on our personal project games. I've been working on like a mobile app just for fun. my business partner and I think one of the artists, I'm not sure if they're working together, they're working together on like a pirate themed couch co-op game. We're all just kind of watching things develop and jamming on our own for a bit. But yes, if it looks like we're going to be, if it looks like we're going to be like several months away from getting quarters from people, then we're going to need to find a way to monetize home.
So Andrea's got a question which goes into the same direction, which is concerning the current Corona situation. How do your cooperation with escape room owners or arcade operators change? Many escape room operators worldwide shifted to different models like GM-based live streaming or building video games from their existing physical rooms.
One really cool room that I got to play, I have no financial ties to this, I didn't work on this or anything, but one really cool room that I got to play is called, the company's called Exodus Escape, and they did, they're doing their escape rooms, it's a physical escape room venue, and they basically, the way it works is you play the escape room over Zoom, and they have one of their staff members in the room with a camera, and you're directing them around saying, open that chest, go to that window. And they've kind of retooled the puzzles a bit, so it's a bit more linear and like simpler, so you can beat it. But it was super fun. That's like one of the most fun escape experiences I've done in recent memory. And so, you know, like a lot of these companies are getting innovative. A lot of them are also just straight up closed. 2-Bit Circus is fully closed right now. They've been doing some live stream content. They have like an educational charitable foundation. And so they've been live streaming activities focused more for kids, but, and they've got a couple programs for adults, but I don't know if they're monetizing it directly. So that's a cool thing I saw. I don't know, like you said in the question, I think the things that you described are what we're seeing. I haven't seen anything else super novel. I think everybody's kind of trying to figure out what's what. Everybody seems to be in a pattern of like, I know we're going to need to pivot somewhat. It's not clear how big or small of a pivot is going to be required. So it seems like everybody's just watching everybody else, like some sort of a quick draw scenario where everybody's just like, what comes next?
So now we also got a question by Jonathan, which may also be covered already, but how regionally isolated is the arcade industry, and like how much in contact are you with, for example, the industry in Europe or the rest of the world?
It's somewhat connected. I would say less connected than video game, like home video games, because I think home video games are generally pretty international. You know, there's localization involved, but I think the games that are popular on console and Steam in Europe probably are similar to the games that are popular on console and Steam in America. I'm not super sure, but I get the sense. In the arcade, I'd say that it's similar but slightly regional. Like I said, Japan kind of has like one of the few exclusive scenes where you go to an arcade in Japan and it looks really different from an arcade anywhere else. It's a really cool, unique scene. I'd say most of the rest of the world has pretty similar scenes, but what you'll see are different SKUs of higher end and lower end expensive wise machines, because some regions, depending on like what the local currency is and conversion between certain currencies, it's just not cost effective to buy these higher end machines that will, I forgot to mention this. Usually with an arcade machine, if you're an operator, you want it to pay for itself within 6 months. When you buy the machine, if it pays for itself within 6 months, that's a good machine. If it pays for itself within like 3 months, that's a great machine. And if it doesn't, it's like, you start looking at the distributor with like a little bit of a, did you sell me junk? Like, why, what's wrong? And this is at a popular arcade, you know, some smaller, less trafficked arcades probably won't do that same number. But when operators are looking at what to buy, they want to make sure that essentially they can get their investment back in about 6 months. And so the thing that I think drives regional differences is that, like, some machines just in some areas, you wouldn't get your money back in 6 months. And so they don't buy them. That's my understanding of it, at least. So it's connected, but it's not perfectly connected. And when it comes to selling to other territories and continents, we usually work with other distributors who have regional expertise there. So essentially, it's like Bandai Namco is the distributor of Hot Wheels for Europe. They have a price that they can buy those cabinets from Adrenaline, the manufacturer, at, and then they resell them. And so they have the expertise in the region. The manufacturer has the expertise in building the unit, and then we're getting a cut of that. And we're slowly learning more about Europe, but, like, we didn't super take it into account in our design philosophy of the game because we just don't really know it yet.
People are saying thank you a lot for the presentation, Mike. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much for having me, Lannis, and thanks everybody listening to me talk about this niche that is, you know, it's unique, it's a lot of fun, and I can be a huge nerd about it. Usually when I'm out somewhere and I start talking about it, people start running the opposite direction because I'm talking about arcade economics. So thank you to my 11 guests who are here. I really appreciate y'all having me here today.
Yeah, it was really a pleasure to have you here. It's really nice and really interesting topic. I mean, arcades and like building them, coming up with an idea and distributing them is a whole lot of stuff to do. And you gave a really nice introduction on that. So thank you very much. I will end the meeting soon, and I will hit you up as soon as the recording is somewhere online. Thank you so much, and have a great day, everybody.
Thanks, everyone.